There has been much confusion and many conflicting and misleading claims as to which cars won what at the Daytona Beach stock car speed and acceleration tests. For example, this Ford ad claiming sweeping victories by the Ford Thunderbird appeared on February 22nd in the Detroit Free Press. This ad was based on runs which were disqualified. The news item of the disqualification was carried by the same paper on February 21st, a day before the Ford ad was printed. Another example of confusing claims was a television commercial for Mercury. The commercial said that Mercury had beaten all other medium-priced cars and all low-priced cars in the stock car race at Daytona Beach, a statement that is technically accurate. But it created in the minds of many people the belief that Mercury beat all other cars and won the race. Actually, Mercury did not win the stock car race at Daytona. A Chrysler 300B won. Now, the examples we've seen serve to confuse rather than inform. So to set the record straight, Chevrolet presents Report on Daytona, based on official results certified by NASCAR. This is the automobile test beach at Daytona Beach, Florida, one of the best-known stretches of oceanfront in the world. This is where automobile history is made year after year. A straightaway of sand, packed and smoothed by the outgoing tide, provides ideal conditions for testing cars of the future and for taking the measure of the cars of today. This beach is really made to order for testing modern machines on wheels, like GM's gas turbine-powered Firebird, cars like Chevrolet's sleek, sporty, and powerful Corvette, cars made in Europe to challenge America's leadership in automobile engineering and design, and cars like those owned, driven, and enjoyed by millions of Americans. Every year in February, dozens of these cars gather at Daytona Beach to take part in the international safety, speed, and acceleration trials held under the supervision of NASCAR. NASCAR stands for the National Association for Stock Car Automobile Racing. It is made up of men and women who like to race stock cars, either professionally or as a hobby. The rules of NASCAR are rigid. Each car taking part in the stock car trials must be strictly stock, the kind that can be bought in any dealership for that make. To make sure, each car is thoroughly inspected before and after its run. Every car entered in the trials makes its run alone, while electronic timers record its speed. All official runs in any event are run the same day so that beach and wind conditions are as nearly the same as possible. First proof of Chevrolet's Super Turbofire V8 outstanding performance came in 1955, when it took top honors in the NASCAR Flying Mile and acceleration events. And in 1956, Chevrolet did it again, easily winning all events in its class, ringing up record-setting flying mile and acceleration speeds, which topped the performance of many higher-priced and higher-powered cars. Now let's look at the official two-way flying mile results as published by NASCAR. But first, let's see how the flying mile is run and timed. The five-mile stretch of beach is divided into three sections. The first 2 miles are for picking up speed, the 1 mile trap or timed portion of the run, and 2 miles for slowing down. To be official, the flying mile must be made twice, once in each direction. The average of these two runs gives a more accurate rating of the car because it takes into consideration the wind, which in one direction might add to a car's speed while slowing it down in the other. Here's a stock Chevrolet powered by Chevrolet's new optional 225 horsepower V8 engine. This engine can be bought through any Chevrolet dealership. It represents the same basic design as in any Chevrolet Turbofire V8. It's been inspected and is ready to roll on its first run of the flying mile. And now it's on its way. It starts smoothly, quietly, as its modern short-stroke engine sends smooth power to the wheels. The wheels take hold in the sand, and it's on its way, faster, faster and faster. It's really rolling as it approaches the measured mile mark and the electronic timer. And here it is, only seconds later at the end of the measured mile. The speed for this run south was 126.895 miles an hour, the fastest south run made in the event for low-price cars. The second fastest south run was made by another Chevrolet with a speed of 124.266 miles an hour. Now for the north run, against the wind. The official timers check the run and announce the speed. The speed on the north run was 116.241 for a two-way average of 121.335, making Chevrolet first in its class and establishing a new record in its class. Another Chevrolet entry is second with an average of 119.245. Still other Chevrolet entries take four more places out of the first 10 for a total of six Chevrolets in the fastest 10. The best Ford speed was third with 118.130 miles, even though a total of 12 230 horsepower Fords were entered. The only Plymouth in the 22 entries came in last with an average of 84.866. Chevrolet's average for the flying mile was faster than some of the entries in the higher price field. For example, a Studebaker Golden Hawk averaged only 118.558. A 340 horsepower Chrysler 300B averaged only 117.321. A Cadillac convertible averaged 113.636. And the best average speed turned in by two Buick Centuries was 111.645. So much for Chevrolet's sensational victories in the flying mile. Now let's see how Chevrolet topped its field in the acceleration test. The acceleration rate is timed over a measured mile from a standing start. The elapsed time over the mile is used to figure the average speed. When the starting flag goes down, the driver gets going as fast as he can. By the end of the mile, the Chevrolet was going well over 100 miles an hour. The result? Chevrolet first again with an average speed of 81.392 miles an hour. And look at this. Chevrolet won 9 out of the first 10 places in its field in the acceleration tests. Proof that Chevrolet's V8 leads the field when it comes to power for get up and go. What's more, Chevrolet's acceleration record of 81.392 topped all but two of the higher priced cars and almost equaled the average of the fastest 340 horsepower Chrysler 300B and 260 horsepower Dodge D500. The Dodge turned in an average of 81.786 and the Chrysler made it 81.762. Chevrolet, although not entered in the higher priced class, had the third fastest acceleration of all stock passengers in the entire event, with 81.392, just a whisker behind these cars which sell for up to twice as much as a Chevrolet. The Dodge D500 and the Chrysler 300B, while they qualify as stock cars, are luxury models with considerably more horsepower than volume production models of these makes. And the speed posted by Chevrolet was decidedly better than all the other higher priced cars. For example, another Chrysler 300B did only 79.952. A Lincoln made it with an average of 79.878. A Cadillac averaged 77.586. And a Mercury posted 81.008. Now let's see how the Chevrolet Corvette fared in the flying mile against the highly touted Ford Thunderbird and European sports cars. Here was the picture on the flying mile for U.S. standard production sports cars. Two stock 1956 Chevrolet Corvettes were entered, one of them driven by Betty Skelton, a widely known flyer and test driver. The other was driven by John Fitch of Stamford, Connecticut. a total of 10 Ford Thunderbirds entered. Let's see the result. First place, Corvette, with runs of 154.972 and 137.195 for a two-way average of 145.543. Second, the Corvette, driven by Betty Skelton, with runs of 145.044 and 131.095 for an average of 137.773. Thus, easily topping the best of the Thunderbirds, which turned an average of 134.404. The averages of the other Thunderbirds were as low as 72.413. The Corvette's flying mile average of 145.543 also beat most of the higher-priced European sports cars, including two Jaguars. The best the two 1956 Jaguars could do were averages of 134.078 and 108.238, far behind the speeds registered by both Corvettes. An Allard entry averaged only 111.111, and a 1956 Austin Healey did only 101.067. And remember, the Jaguar sells for much more than the Corvette. In the acceleration run for production sports cars, there were two Corvette entries and 12 Thunderbirds. The fastest run by a Corvette in this event was an average of 86.872, beating the speed turned in by 10 of the Thunderbirds. The Corvette driven by Betty Skelton ran the mile at an average of 85.531 to beat 9 of the Thunderbirds. The fastest production sports car acceleration time was made by a Thunderbird with an average of 88.779. However, this was topped by a Chevrolet Cameo Carrier pickup truck equipped with a Corvette engine. It averaged 89.524 miles an hour to beat all acceleration speeds with the exception of that made by another Chevrolet. A modified Corvette, which accelerated to an average of 89.753 miles. Earlier, this same modified Corvette ran the two-way flying mile at an average speed of 147.3 miles an hour and a one-way run at 155.642. Under NASCAR rules, a modified car is one that is basically stock, with the exception of some parts or specifications. This Corvette was equipped with a pan underneath for additional streamlining and an engine that was standard except for a higher compression ratio. The tail fin, for added stability, does not add to its speed or power and is not considered a modification. Of course, there were some events that Chevrolets could not win. And the reason is simple. Chevrolets were not entered. For example, a Ford 6 won the Class 4 flying mile. It couldn't lose because no other car of any make was entered. And Chevrolet did not compete against prototype cars like this Plymouth Fury. Prototype means that the car is not yet in full production and is not to be considered a stock car. The Plymouth Fury uses a 303 cubic inch displacement engine of 240 horsepower, while regular production Plymouth engines are smaller and have considerably less horsepower. Yes, automotive history was made at Daytona Beach in February, with all major makes of cars competing. And in event after event, Chevrolet won sweeping victories in speed and acceleration. But what do all these victories mean to the average buyer of an automobile? The average owner most likely will never want, never need, and never have the occasion to drive or accelerate as fast as they did in Daytona. But the average driver does want a car that responds when he wants to pass, holds the road steady when he's on a fast curve, and handles easily and sure-footedly in heavy traffic. And he wants a car that has the durability and stamina to take the roughest roads and highest mountains. Chevrolet's sweeping and record-making victories at Daytona prove that it has power, performance, stability, stamina, and durability, the things every buyer is entitled to get when he invests in a car. That's why only Chevrolet is first in sales, in exclusive engineering features, and in performance on the highway, as well as on the test tracks. Yes, Daytona proves the hot ones even hotter for 56. And no one cools it off.